Good morning. Good morning. We welcome you this morning to Tabernacle Baptist Church. We're glad on this Lord's Day. You've gathered with God's people. This is our privilege. We can come together in His name and join our hearts and minds and voices together as we worship our mighty King. Do have a couple of announcements to make before we then turn our attention to worship this morning. One, today is the third Sunday of the month, so there will be children's church this morning, all right, and they will be released right before the sermon, so parents, you may want to be aware of that and prepared for such an event, all right, so we'll do that just before the sermon, but I'll release them when I step up here to do that. Also, there's a number of events that will not be going on for the rest of the year, so just to be mindful of that. There will be no Sunday evening activities tonight or next Sunday. There will also be no Wednesday night activities this Wednesday or the next Wednesday. All right, so keep that in mind. But we will have Christmas Eve, so there are two options, as we've been saying, for you to worship with us on Christmas Eve. There will be an online option. We have pre-recorded a service that will be available to you at 4:00. On Christmas Eve. And so if you feel like that is the best option for you and your family, we encourage you to take advantage of that. But at 4:30, we will have a live service. All right, so we will be here and 4:30, we'll enjoy a Christmas Eve service together. If you'd like to be a part of that service, we ask that you sign up so that we can continue to have an idea of those who would like to come and be a part of the in-person service that we will be having. But would encourage you to do that. As the signups have gone so far, it is at a number which allows us to social distance, and I think the environment will still provide plenty of space in order to do that together. So would encourage you to do so if you'd like to be in person. Also, one of the ways we traditionally as a Southern Baptist church would recognize the Christmas season is with a special offering. So every year we take up the Lottie Moon Christmas offering for international missions. All that is taken up during this time of year goes to Southern Baptist missionaries serving on the field in international settings. And so we've been asking all month for you to pray about giving. We appreciate those who have given, but if you've not yet done so, you can give through the end of the month. And again, we'd encourage you to do that. But to give you a little bit of an idea of the ministry that is going on, what that looks like, who we are supporting. We've got a video this morning, and of a very familiar family. The Wallers have a video for us and their mission field. And so I invite you to watch the video, and then we'll enter into a time of worship together.
Hi, we're the Waller family, and we serve with the International Mission Board in Bulgaria. Thank you for partnering with us through the Lottie Moon Christmas offering.
Greetings from Bulgaria. We're the Waller family. My name is Caleb.
I'm Sarah.
I'm Hannah.
I'm Ben.
And this is Eliza.
And we have been serving in Bulgaria with the International Mission Board for 5 years. And we just want to thank you for your generous gifts to the Lottie Moon Christmas offering. 100% of these gifts go to support missionary families just like ours, serving all around Europe and all around the world.
We want to thank you for your love, your support, your prayers, and we want to wish you all a
Merry Christmas!
We love you.
Bye.
My name is Caleb Waller, and I, along with my family, serve with the International Mission Board in Bulgaria. We've been here for almost 5 years, and one of the only ways that we get to be here and serve and share the gospel with those that have never heard it is because of your gifts to the Southern Baptist Convention's Lottie Moon Christmas offering. You may be asking, who is Lottie Moon and why is she so important? Well, you see, Lottie Moon was one of the first female missionaries to serve with the International Mission Board, what was then called the Foreign Mission Board of the Southern Baptist Convention. And she served for almost 40 years in China. But one of her biggest contributions was that she worked tirelessly to encourage Southern Baptists back then to unite together to create an annual Christmas offering that would go to support missionaries on the field just like her, but also go to send additional help, to send additional missionaries out into the harvest. Well, you see, now here in 2020, there are thousands of missionary families just like ours on the field because of your generosity. This year, after what has been a challenging year for all of us, we are calling Southern Baptists to unite once again, to give sacrificially to this wonderful annual Christmas offering where 100% of the gifts go to support missionary families just like ours. Your gifts to this offering help provide ministry resources, provide health care, education for our children, a vehicle to support our family, resources so that we're able to get the gospel to those who need it the most. You sustain us with an apartment and with language resources and so, so much more. And so we want to thank you because we would not be able to do what we do without you. Your sacrificial gifts allow you to be part of our team. We are working together on the greatest cause and for the greatest task that the world has ever known, that of making the name of Christ famous where he is currently ignored, where he is currently neglected, or where he may not be known at all. And so we want to thank you this year for your gifts, for partnering with our family of five, but also with those thousands of families that are serving around the world, some in places that we can't even mention because they're so difficult. We thank you. We want to wish you the very merriest of Christmases this year as we reflect on the hope and peace that we have because of our Savior. But continue to give. Let's give generously and sacrificially this year so that those who have never heard the name of Christ or ever heard the good news about him can have that similar hope, that same peace that we have down in our hearts that have allowed us to push through this year. So thank you again. We wish you a Merry Christmas. We thank you for your prayers and support. And we ask that you would continue to share the name of Christ boldly with those around you and allow us to do the same here on the field. Merry Christmas.
Amen. Good morning. It is the fourth Sunday of Advent, and once again, we are reading from God's Word about the second coming of Christ and lighting one more candle to signify light coming into darkness. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, and I'm inviting you to read responsively where it's indicated, beginning in verse 2. For you yourselves are fully aware that the day of the Lord will come like a thief in the night. While people are saying there is peace and security, then sudden destruction will come upon them as labor pains come upon a pregnant woman, and they will not escape. But you are not in darkness, brothers, for that day to surprise you like a thief. For you are all children of light, children of the darkness, children of the day. We are not of the night nor of the darkness. So then, let us not sleep as others do, but let us keep awake and be sober. For those who sleep, sleep at night, and those who get drunk are drunk at night. But since we belong to the day, let us be sober, having put on the breastplate of faith and love, and for a helmet, the hope of salvation. For God has not destined us for wrath, but to obtain salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ, who died for us, so that whether we are awake or asleep, we might live with him. Therefore, encourage one another and build one another up, just as you are doing. And Jesus said, surely I am coming soon. Amen. Amen. Come, Lord Jesus. And so we light our fourth Advent candle as a sign of the coming light of Christ. And that light of Christ comes to give us a spirit of faith and of love and of hope like we've just read. So brothers and sisters, God is calling you this morning to worship him in faith and love and hope. Maybe that means you're struggling with unbelief. Maybe you question where God is in the midst of your trials that you're going through. To you this morning, God says, while you're among his people today, remember what Christ has done for you and put on that breastplate of faith. maybe you're struggling to love. Maybe you have relationships that are strained or offenses that have turned into bitterness. God says to you this morning, remember what Christ has done for you and put on the breastplate of love. Maybe you're disillusioned or disappointed, feeling overwhelmed and overcome by the darkness in the world and the darkness of the sin that's in your own heart. God says this morning, remember what Christ has done for you and put on the helmet of the hope of salvation. Brothers and sisters, we should be encouraged and sing with joy because above any and every concern that we can possibly have, the prevailing truth that governs our lives is that God has not destined us for wrath, but to obtain salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ. Let's stand together as we sing this morning. Let's turn our minds and our hearts now to a time of prayer together, if you'll bow your heads with me. Holy God, we do come to adore you this morning, and we acknowledge you as our only hope of salvation. And we thank you for coming to dwell with us, for pursuing us, and redeeming us by your death and resurrection. Father, your word tells us that you sent your Son into the world to deliver all those who through the fear of death were subject to lifelong slavery. And we rejoice that you came to deliver us from the fear of death. And now we're living in a time where we need that promise to be close on our minds and our hearts, shaping our thoughts and our attitudes. And so this morning we pray for our world and our country as we continue to deal with the COVID-19 pandemic. Father, we ask your mercy and comfort on families who have lost loved ones. We ask your healing on patients who are battling the disease and protection on those who are treating and caring for them. We ask your wisdom for decision makers, especially in our own city and county and state, and even right here in our church. We ask your wisdom for ourselves, each as citizens of a community and ambassadors for Christ, that we would search your word as we cope with and respond to the whirlwind of news and opinions and doubts and fears around us. God, help us be a people who display hope and peace through our confidence in an almighty God. The same hope and peace that we so often sing about during this time of year. Help us be people who are wise and also faithful. Help us display a radical fear of God and supernatural, spirit-inspired hope of eternity in the face of a culture enslaved by the fear of death and the fear of man. Help us use this moment in history as an opportunity to proclaim that we know the only God and the only Savior capable of delivering us from the fear of death and the grave, because you alone have conquered the grave. And Father, for the sake of that gospel message, this morning we also join with our Southern Baptist brothers and sisters as we give to the Lottie Moon offering to support the work of missionary families who sacrificially take that gospel to the lost around the world. Father, we ask that we and our fellow Baptists would be generous and sacrificial in our giving. But even more than that, we ask your blessing and mercy and protection on all of our missionaries and their families. And particularly this morning, we bring before you the Millers serving in Mexico, the Wallers serving in Bulgaria, and the Willards serving in Uganda. Lord, we ask that you keep them safe. We ask that you make them bold and courageous in their gospel work and proclamation. We ask that you provide for their needs. And we ask that you comfort them through the difficulty of living far away from friends and family. Lord, now as we prepare to open your word and hear it taught, give us ears to hear your voice. Inform our minds in truth and move our affections with joy and gratefulness that we would will to give you ever more glory and follow you ever more faithfully. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
A seeker for light in a dark world. I looked for truth, but settled for lies. I had been blinded. I couldn't see. Star in Bethlehem's sky, open my eyes. I have has seen the light shining in the darkness, bursting through the shadows, delivering the dawn. I have seen the light whose holy name is Jesus. His kingdom is forever. He reigns on heaven's throne. An innocent baby, who would believe that he was a one? I can believe it. I know it's true. He changed my life. He is the light. He is God's Son. I have seen the light shining in the darkness, bursting through the shadows, delivering the throne. We must tell the world what we've seen today in Bethlehem. He's a promised King. We bow down and worship Him. We will worship Christ the King. I have seen the light shining in the darkness, bursting through the shadows, delivering the dawn. I have seen the light. Throne. I have seen the light of Jesus.
I have seen the light of the Lord.
I have seen the light of Jesus.
I have seen the light.
I have seen the light of the Lord.
Amen. Thank you, John, Craig, singing for us. And thank you, John, worship leaders, leading us. And John, as you prayed, thank you for giving us an opportunity to come before our God and to glorify His great name. If you would take your Bibles, turn with me to Isaiah chapter 40. And as you turn there, we will dismiss our children at this time. They can make their way. Miss June is here, and she'll take them to their location for Children's Church. As they are making their way out, would also encourage you, if you didn't have an opportunity last Sunday night to be with us for the Lessons and Carols. It was a fantastic night of music, not only that which was performed for us, but also an opportunity to sing. So that's available online. You can go to the church's website and you can watch that service. So if you didn't get a chance to do that last week, would encourage you to do so. So that's all the children of physical age who've made their way. All right. Isaiah chapter 40. This morning we will bring at least this portion of our Christmas focus on this chapter, this language of comfort extended to God's people, by looking at verses 9 through 11. Isaiah chapter 40, beginning in verse 9. O Zion, you who bring good tidings, get up into the high mountain. O Jerusalem, you who bring good tidings, lift up your voice with strength, lift it up, be not afraid. Say to the cities of Judah, behold your God. Behold, the Lord God shall come with a strong hand, and his arm shall rule for him. Behold, his reward is with him, and his work before him. He will feed his flock like a shepherd. He will gather the lambs with his arm and carry them in his bosom and gently lead those who are with young. It's one of the oldest English Christmas carols, with some lyrics of it supposedly going all the way back to the 16th century. Its first real published form, kind of as we know it, came in 1760. It was a part of a collection of what was entitled Three New Carols, contemporary worship of its day. All right, so Three New Carols, 1760, but within 100 years, this song became so beloved that it was simply known as the Old Christmas Carol. Now, it even shows up in the Dickens Christmas classic, A Christmas Carol. I'm sure we're all familiar with the story. There's one point where a young boy attempts to instill a little bit of Christmas cheer into Ebenezer Scrooge. And so he tries to sing to him this particular carol before being run off with the threat of violence. And here were the few words that he got out. God rest ye merry gentlemen, let nothing you dismay. Now, I'm not going to sing the rest of it. You've heard people who can sing. I know my lane. However, I imagine the rest of us could fill out the rest of what is this great song. For Jesus Christ, our Savior, was born on Christmas Day to save us all from Satan's power when we were gone astray. And then it repeats a chorus, a refrain, shows up after every verse, and it says this, O tidings of comfort and joy, comfort and joy. O tidings of comfort and joy. You know, there's a number of important concepts that come to the forefront during the Christmas season. They're represented in the Advent candle. We have love, joy, peace, hope. Then these four really get the lion's share of attention, and we can understand why. I mean, these are important images. They deal with essential realities of the gospel itself. But I would argue there's a fifth quality that deserves the same kind of press and attention. And that is the language of comfort. That right along with love and joy and hope and peace is this message of Christmas that is a message of God's comfort. This is the message we've been reflecting on for the last, now this will be our third week as we've considered the message of Christmas and turned our attention to Isaiah 40. Now, Isaiah 40, I'm convinced, and we've talked about the elements of this already, but Isaiah 40 is very clearly a text that draws our attention to the Christmas story. I mean, the beginning words maybe not right away as God calls out, comfort, comfort my people, speak words of comfort to Jerusalem. But as we get into it, we see the language of Isaiah 40 speaking to John the Baptist. And we see Isaiah 40 speaking to the message of the incarnation or God coming in the flesh. And this morning we'll see is what we just read. We have this imagery of God manifesting Himself and God shepherding His people. Isaiah 40 is a chapter that does feature prominently, prophetically, as far as the Christmas story is concerned. And I'm certain New Testament authors, particularly the gospel writers, and those who emphasize the Christmas story, certainly draw from the imagery here of Isaiah 40. And what Isaiah 40 is designed to do is, as this kicks off the second part of the book of Isaiah, drawing attention to a people who are in exile, a broken people, a sinful people, wounded and weary people. I don't know if that sounds familiar to anybody. All right, so in other words, it's a message that doesn't just apply to roughly 2,500 years ago. As God speaks to a people under the burden of sin, their own sin, and then the burden of exile, God speaks this word of comfort to them, drawing their attention to what is a greater promise to come. What is going to be God's grace? What's going to be God's mercy? God's own redemption, presence, and glory. And so this is what we've been looking at. Isaiah 40, we find the prophet declaring God's words to His people, declaring this simple yet profound message of what is His own presence, what is His own work of redemption, and His own glory. So as we've looked at it, we've considered what are the ways in which this speaks comfort to us. Isaiah 40 is a message that then comes straight to us, especially as we look back on the fulfillment of some of this in the Christmas story. And when we look forward to what will be a future fulfillment of this with the second coming, as we consider then these important words, they speak comfort to us. We can be assured of these promises. We ourselves can be comforted by God's message of redemption, His presence, and His glory to come. So how does it speak to us? Well, this is what often happens, by the way, when sermon series unfold. Well, when your pastor does sermon series, all right? What starts off as a few points becomes more. And so this morning, it's just a Christmas miracle, all right? Merry Christmas. It's a Merry Christmas to you. You get more blanks to fill in. And so there you go. So we've been looking at ways in which Isaiah 40 comforts us. Well, we've looked at two. We're going to look at four more this morning. Now, the first two we've already considered. Isaiah 40 draws our attention to the comfort afforded to us by God's redemption. That key phrase in verses 1 and 2. God has pardoned our iniquity. Sins have been paid for. And then the second one we looked at last week, comforted by God's revelation. God has made Himself known. And we looked at that text that foreshadows the coming of John the Baptist. God is declaring ahead of time what is going to be His coming. That He's going to come and He's going to manifest His own glory. And though the text ended in somewhat of a good news, bad news scenario, as we looked at especially like verses 7 and 8, where this message then is cried out that as humans, we're like the flowers and we're like grass. We've got a momentary, fleeting kind of beauty. Flower fades, right? The grass is going to wither. But then we have the Word of God, this promise that stands forever. And so we noted how God has revealed Himself and His promises, and we can draw great comfort for that. Well, that's going to lead then into the third. A way in which we receive comfort is expressed in this text. We are comforted by God's presence. Comforted by God's presence. Notice how the message continues in verse 9. O Zion, you bring good tidings. Get up into the high mountains. O Jerusalem, you who bring good tidings, lift up your voice with strength. Lift it up. Be not afraid. Now, stop there for just a moment. So, right from the beginning, what the prophet is being instructed to do is the message that's about to be declared is so important, it is so grand, that the imagery that expresses this the best is they need to find the highest point available to them. They need to go up on the high mountain, so find the place where they can get as high as they can and declare the message as far and as broadly as they can. And in fact, you'll note, he even says to raise your voice, lift up your voice with strength, and do so in a bold and courageous way. Be not afraid. So before we even get to what the message is, I mean, he begins by drawing attention to what is a profound message. He's saying you need to find a way in which this can be declared in the broadest possible sense. You know, we would use a phrase today, I'm going to shout it from the rooftops. And I hesitate to use this analogy because I don't know if you've ever picked up on this. I have a bit of a grumpy opinion about social media. Have you ever noticed that? Anybody ever picked up on that? Yeah. If you haven't, you may want to listen carefully because it comes out every now and then. But perhaps he might would say something like, proclaim this on every social media platform you've got. In other words, this message needs to get as far as it can go. It needs to be heard by as many people as could hear it. And you need to shout it. Well, what's the message? Notice the very end of verse 9. Say to the cities of Judah, behold your God. You know, now at first glance, we read that and think, wow, that seems a bit anticlimactic. I thought it maybe would be a bit more of a punch, right? Maybe a bit more powerful. This is the thing I need to declare. Well, the language that's being used here, when he says, behold, the word behold means to look. It's to draw attention to. It's to see. And in fact, some other translations use that kind of language. To say behold is to draw attention to something that is actually present, that is actually there, right? And if I wanted to, and again, it's a way to emphasize, you need to do this right away. You need to take this all in. This is the most pressing thing about your reality right now. So maybe, you know, this is a silly way to put it, but let's say we're driving around looking at lights. All right, if I want to draw your attention, I might say, behold, out the left side, there's Christmas lights. All right, so I know that'd be a little dramatic for Christmas, but that is what I'm wanting you to do is to turn your attention to gaze on a literal, tangible thing. So when he's saying, get to the top, here's what's interesting about it. He's using what, you know, metaphorical, poetic kind of language to talk about something very literal and very real. Get up on a high mountain and declare this with boldness. In fact, do not fear that this is the case. Let the nation and the nations know. Behold your God. In fact, the New American Standard will even say, hear. Is your God. What the prophet is emphasizing here is the literalness of the event. He's not speaking in metaphor. He is telling the people, observe, gaze upon. This is a literal, in the flesh statement. I have no doubt that a partial fulfillment of this promise is the incarnation, meaning when God is enfleshed, right? That this is clearly the intent of the New Testament authors to draw our attention to this. When he says, behold our God, he is saying, look at him who has arrived. This is impressing upon us his literal, tangible presence. It's really an encouraging truth. And it's a reminder to us about something important about the work of the gospel. God did not leave us to save ourselves. That's not an option. God did not merely send a recording via the phone tree, all right, to let us know about how to be saved. It's not an email. It's not a package that was delivered that gives you a nice handwritten note even. The means by which God demonstrated his desire to save was to personally show up, to come in the flesh, to do for us what we cannot do for ourselves. And this is why I think the prophet is including this kind of a message in a chapter that is drawing our attention to God's comfort. Behold, God has arrived. This is the intent of that message about John the Baptist in verses 3 through 5. There's going to be a highway made for our God. There's going to be valleys that will be brought up. And there's going to be mountains that are going to be made low. There's going to be crooked paths that are straightened. There's going to be rough paths that are hewn over so that the glory of God may be seen. Behold, look, gaze upon. It's drawing our attention to what is the presence of God. Again, this is clearly fulfilled, at least in a partial sense, in the New Testament. It is the intent, I think, of the New Testament authors to draw our attention to this. What is one of the most famous Christmas stories? The appearance of the angels to the shepherds, right? So consider this, all right? This is probably not the first time you've read this. I'm sure it won't be the last. Though, as I told the early service, as a pastor, as a trained professional, I'm not allowed to talk about this after the 25th of December, all right? So this is it, because that's just the rule. You can only talk about this in December, apparently. We're only allowed to read this during Christmas, because it's the only time we ever hear it. So you need to be prepared. One year, I just may do everything out of order, okay? Because everybody tells me I got to do it this way. And what do I love to tell people who want to tell me what to do? You're not the boss of me. Yeah, all right, some of you have gotten it. Good, all right, good. For now, we'll do it today. All right. So the message, the first part of chapter 2 gives us the story of Joseph and Mary making their way to Bethlehem, all right, the birth of Christ. And then we're taken to a different scene outside of Bethlehem in the countryside. And there were in the same country shepherds living out in the fields, keeping watch over their flock by night. And behold, an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were greatly afraid. Then the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people." Now, right off the bat, before we even get to the next part, how can this not be some kind of echo of what we just read, right? Because that's exactly what he's just saying. He's saying, you know, to go up, to declare good tidings, to not be afraid, because there's a message. Now, what is that message? Why is it that this can be declared? Why is it a message of good tidings? Again, to me, there's no doubt, at least part of this is coming from Isaiah 40. Why is this the case? Well, the next part. Again, you're familiar with it. For there is born to you this day in the city of David a Savior who is Christ the Lord. And this will be the sign to you. You will find a babe wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in a manger. And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill toward men." Now again, that is so familiar. We hear that so often. Well, so often every year, right? I mean, we don't hear it often, really. We hear it once a year, at least. But understand this incredible message that the angels are saying. The angels are telling shepherds, God has been born in the flesh. You notice that the angels don't say, "Glory to God in the highest." They don't say, "Behold, here's the message of good tidings. God appeared as a 30-year-old man and he's down in Bethlehem." Doesn't say that. It doesn't say, "There's another angel down in Bethlehem. He's got the rest of the story." There's nothing that says that. What is the message? There's been one who's been born. In fact, it is such a birth. It's the real thing. He's been born. He's wrapped in swaddling clothes. He's lying in a manger. And in fact, what this really represents is peace and goodwill toward men. In other words, what are the angels doing here? What are they telling the shepherds? They are telling the shepherds, God has arrived. This is the glorious and great message. God has shown up. He's come to earth. He's revealed himself. He is present. This is the promise of Isaiah 40. Behold your God. God is going to come himself to do for us what we could not do for ourselves. I like how one commentator put it. Salvation is neither more nor less than the divine presence. God does not save his people with programs sent from afar, neither does he save them with theological conceptions coolly administered from on high. He comes. He comes in the flesh. He came personally, literally. He left the throne. He humbled himself and took on the likeness of man, and that should not be underestimated. In all of its fullness, became a man. Die on the cross and be raised from the dead so that we could be made right with God. I mean, this is the message. This is why he says, behold your God. And when we reflect on Isaiah 40 in light of what we know the rest of the New Testament to say, then we recognize this is a partial fulfillment. But understand, church, this is just a partial fulfillment. When he says, behold your God, go and declare this from the mountaintops, shout this to the farthest reaches, make sure you get the biggest and widest audience you can find in order to declare this message, that this is one of those ways in which Isaiah is a now and not yet kind of a prophet. Part of it's been fulfilled. But there's more to come. It's not just the first coming. There will be another literal, real, physical coming of the Lord. Just as we could not save ourselves, we also cannot put the world back into order. Did you hear that? You, me, nor any human being on the planet can put it back into order. Only the King can do that. Just like we could not save ourselves, we cannot restore this earth to be free from the curse. So he must come. Unless you think there's no more sin and death and rebellion in the world. It's a tough sell, all right? But you're welcome to convince me afterwards, okay? I'm pretty sure there's a little bit going around here and there. So that means there's something left to be done. So this is pointing us to a second coming. The very last book of the Bible gives us this statement. It gives it to us at the beginning of the last book, Revelation 1:7. Behold, he is coming with clouds, and every eye will see him, even they who pierced him. And all the tribes of the earth will mourn because of him. Even so, amen. Isn't it fascinating that he begins the book that talks about the end by giving us the end of the story? Does that make sense? No, that probably doesn't. Do you know what I'm getting at? So this is verse 7. This is the 7th verse, first chapter, and he gives us the end already. He sums it up. How do I know it's the end? Because he used the word amen. Because that's what we do when we're done, right? That's when you go for the food, right? After amen. That's when we know, all right, okay, it's done. Yeah, it was a long blessing. Time to eat, right? But he begins here by saying, so this is the end of the thing. This is the final and principal point. Behold, he is coming. And how is he coming? Symbolically, metaphorically, poetically? Every eye will see him. Well, what about, no, every eye will see him. But there are people, every eye will see him. Now, John's not the first one to say it, right? And that's exactly what's said here in Isaiah 40. It's what's said in verse 5. The glory of the Lord shall be revealed, and all flesh shall see it together. Behold your God. No, he's coming again. And so this is the promise of his presence. This is a comforting word to us. We should be comforted by this, church. The coming of our Lord, the first coming, a manifestation of his very real and literal presence. That's not the end of the story. There's another coming that is on the way. He will come in glory and splendor,
in a literal, physical, visible way. All right, let's go on to number four. So you're going to have to listen to the rest of it really fast. All right? We're also comforted by God's might. Because what happens here is after he says, behold your God, there's then a series of statements he makes about what we are to behold. And so he adds to this that the manner in which he will come. So notice verse 10, behold the Lord God shall come with a strong hand and his arm shall rule for him. I mean, it means what it says. When he comes, he will come to rule and reign. He will come with authority. He will come with might. He will come with power. Now, this is clearly a case where there is a portion of this yet to be fulfilled. I mean, this can't be just about Christmas, right? Because we know the world that we live in is full of brokenness and despair and sin. Our own hearts is full of that as well. I mean, this is just the nature of living still under the curse, though by the gospel we've been freed from it, made right with God, justified in the eyes of God. Yet at the same time, we still are under what is the burden of a cursed reality. So the promise is then made when he comes. He's going to come in might. He's going to come with a strong arm. He's going to come to rule and reign. Now, to be sure, the first coming of Christ was one of great power. In what way? He showed his power over demons. He showed his power over disease. He showed his power over death, right? And this is what Jesus did in his earthly ministry. He demonstrated this great authority and power, but that was only a foretaste of something greater to come. That there is coming a day when we will enjoy the rule and reign of the King. There's coming a day when he will come in might and in power. And I love this promise, because this promise points me to the fact that the King that I serve now, who rules and reigns in my heart and should rule and reign in your heart, should rule and reign in his church, he will rule and reign in a manifest glory and power over every square inch of all things. All things will be brought into subjection to him. And so we can trust that with this coming, he will come with might. We're comforted by God's might. Number five, we are comforted by God's reward. Then it says in that second part of the phrase, behold, his reward is with him and his work before him. So it's another comforting word to us. He will come in might. And there's really, I think, two groups in mind here. If you're an unbeliever, this should be terrifying. In fact, part of the way we have recognized the Christmas season, the way we've done Advent, and I so much appreciate this about how John has led us to focus our attention not just on sweet sentimental stories of the first century, but the profound theological realities of the second coming, because that's really what we should be doing in the Advent season. We should be thinking about what will be the second coming of Christ. And as we just read, my guess is you're not reading a whole lot of 1 Thessalonians chapter 5 during the Christmas season, right? Not a whole lot of the great day of the Lord and destruction. That may not be in your Christmas devotion come Friday morning. Maybe you should add it, all right? Because this is an important part of what we are talking about. In the grand scheme of the theological realities of what is Christ, his first coming and his second coming, this involves the day of the Lord. And that day involves God coming with might. And if you are an unbeliever, then just like we read in Revelation chapter 1, verse 7, the nations will tremble at it. They'll mourn. If you are an unbeliever, you do not want to see God coming in his might. Just read the rest of Revelation to see what that looks like. Even if you don't understand all of Revelation, I promise you, you'll understand enough to know you don't want to be that guy. You don't want to be the unbeliever when he comes in might. But for us, for children of the King, for sons and daughters of God, Oh, it's going to be a much different thing. See, because when He comes, He will come with His reward. Now, make no mistake about this. We enjoy some of the reward of salvation now. I mean, what does it mean to believe the gospel? To recognize I'm a sinner and unable to save myself. And then in full faith to confess. Jesus died on the cross and rose from the dead. And to ask God to save me based on what Christ and Christ alone has done. That is the promise of the gospel. That when I call on the name of the Lord, I shall be saved. That is an ultimate eternal promise. That those who believe on the Lord Jesus Christ are saved. Their sins are forgiven. They are saved from the wrath to come. We stand justified before God, reconciled to Him, the righteousness of Christ placed upon us, our unrighteousness paid for in Jesus Christ. But we don't have all the promises. We don't have all the promises that are stated about what that day will look like. I mean, let's just pick out a big one. Is there any sickness and death? It's not gone yet, right? Are there any tears left in the eyes of people? What about for God's people? Do we ever find ourselves weeping, dealing with grief, the brokenness and tragedies of this world, brokenness and tragedies of our own actions and decisions? Yes, yes, and yes. In other words, there are promises related to salvation that are now, but they are not yet. Yes, I've received them in one sense, but there's a greater fulfillment to come. And there is a day coming when that same God, manifest in a manger, Word made flesh, born, that same God will return, but there will be no manger for Him. Won't be any swaddling clothes. When He comes in power, He will come not only ruling with His mighty arm, but He will come with the reward that is made available to the people of God. And you and I will enter into that lasting and final experience where there's no more tears, there's no more crying, there's no more pain, there's no more sin, there's no more death, there's no more hurt, there's no more virus, there's no more elections, none of it will matter when the King of Kings comes. We can be comforted by that. Comforted by the reward that will come to us. The reward that is promised to us in the gospel. This is the good news. Let's also make something undeniable here, church. It's the only way it's going to change. It's the only way it's going to change. We require God to intervene. So this is going to lead to our last one. And that is, we are comforted by God's compassion. We are comforted by God's compassion. So then we get to a really familiar image here in verse 11. We not only behold this God who comes with might, this God who comes with His reward, but then it also says, He will feed His flock like a shepherd. He will gather the lambs with His arm and carry them in His bosom and gently lead those who are with young. Boy, the imagery of the shepherd to the sheep. Is there any more common of an image in the Bible about this relationship? I mean, I don't think so. This is all familiar imagery, right? We don't have to think very hard about this one. We see it in the Christmas story. And again, that's the shepherds, right? Why else would there be shepherds who would be called upon to go testify, witness to the birth of Christ? I mean, part of this is clearly this connection here with what is an Old Testament imagery. Can anybody else think of any passage of Scripture that talks about God being shepherd? Is there any other one that maybe sounds vaguely familiar, right? I mean, it's one of the texts that just about everybody knows, right? Psalm 23. The Lord being our shepherd and us not wanting and Him leading us beside these still waters into green pastures. And this was written by who? Shepherd. David. And David who stands as the Old Testament image of the shepherd king. That's one of the images that is used about him. That God wants to shepherd His people through David, His shepherd king. But this only points us to what is other Old Testament imagery. In fact, the language of us as sheep and God as shepherd shows up about half a dozen times in David's Psalms. Jeremiah and Ezekiel, they both testify to the fact that this is what's going to happen. God is going to come and God will shepherd his people Israel. And this is then manifest in the Christmas story. Not only in this imagery of shepherds coming to see Jesus when he was born, but one of the great statements Jesus makes about his own divinity. John chapter 10. He identifies himself as the good shepherd. And he goes on to say that my sheep know my voice. At one point, Jesus is looking out on his people, and the Bible says he's moved with compassion because when he sees Israel, they are like sheep without a shepherd. I mean, this is the clear language of the New Testament. And for the most part, when we read this, when we hear about this, that he will feed, gather, carry, and lead us. That's really sweet language, right? I mean, it kind of warms the heart. This makes good, Christmas cards. This would make good Hallmark cards, right? I mean, this makes for warm feelings to think about God as our shepherd and how he loves us and the gentleness of it and the compassion of it. But you do know there's another side to this. I know what you're thinking. Oh, man. That pastor loves to ruin the Bible for us, all right? He takes all these things we love, and then he comes around on the backside and tells us why we're all wrong and what we thought about him, all right? No, I mean, for sure, God is a God, the leading, the carrying, the gentleness. Yes, this is a part of it. But why is it that God decides to use, of all of the images he could use, why is a premier image of our relationship to him as sheep to shepherd? Why is it that it talks about the shepherd feeding, carrying, leading, and gathering? Because sheep are really dumb. I mean, I don't know what else to tell you. And don't worry, I'm one of them too, all right? So before you think, wow, I came to church and I got offended. He ruined the Bible for me. He offended me. He's going long. All right, so I understand all of that is... Merry Christmas, all right? This is what we do. Pastors love to do this. We get grumpy at Christmas time. So, all right, but this is important though. This is why I think this is such an important image when it comes to the image of shepherd. Why did God choose this one? Because sheep, and we've talked about this before, that they don't naturally find their own food. I mean, they need to be led to it. And in fact, that great part of Psalm 23 where it says he leads us beside still waters, I've read that the reason is because a sheep will try and drink out of raging waters. He'll get wet, he can't carry himself, he falls in and drowns. He can't even find the right kind of water. He needs somebody to lead him, to guide him, to carry him. I mean, is there anything out there where the sheep is the known predator for it? Is there any other animal out there thinking, oh no, here comes a sheep, right? No, no. I mean, it's not an image. You're not sitting down thinking, uh-oh, is that sheep I hear? All right. You know, so no one's intimidated by the imagery of sheep. And I'm not saying that I guess they got hooves. I don't know. Anyway, all right, I don't know anything about them. I'm just saying that there's a lot of other really intimidating and even cool animals we could be compared to. Instead, he uses sheep. Because it not only describes his tenderness and compassion toward us, it describes our desperate need. God is compassionate with me because I have no other choice. He has to be. Otherwise, I'm dead. He has to be compassionate. He has to do this stuff. And this is the beauty of the Christmas story. This is why it is such a profound message, because this is what God has done. God has not left us to our own devices. He's not left us to just wander the wild on our own. God intervened to do for us what we could not do for ourselves. A forever king ruling on a forever throne over a forever kingdom, a God of grace and a God of mercy has provided a means by which you and I could be saved, where we can have that salvation now as a constant, eternal promise, and then a fullness of it to be revealed at the end. God is a shepherd. Church, be comforted by this. Be comforted by all of the messages we have here in Isaiah 40. God's redemption, his revelation, his presence, his might, his reward, and his compassion. And let that be a comfort to you, church. And so at this point, let me then also be pastoral. Let me provide a little bit of shepherding. Let this be the message that is dominating your thoughts. Let this be the message that you are consuming, not just Isaiah 40, but God's word and God's promises. And I say that in contrast to something else, because I understand the way the world's going. I understand there are pressing issues that our world and our country and our community and state are facing. I get that. But I am telling you, if the lion's share of the information you're consuming is world-based and earthly-based and earthly solutions-based, then you are doing it wrong. I will tell you again. Some of you need to turn the news off. You need to turn it off. Oh, but Pastor, you won't be informed about what? About what may or may not be true? Is that what you won't be informed by? Well, I mean, if I turn off my news feed, oh, so you won't get the top trending story that, again, may or may not be meaningful? In fact, probably isn't. My goodness, how did God's people ever survive without 24-hour news? See, the truth is some of this stuff, and again, it could be fine stuff. I'm not saying it's all wrong or necessarily evil, but I'm telling you, if the majority of the messages you are receiving are coming from earthly sources and they are about earthly solutions to earthly problems, that will infect your heart and your mind, and it will influence your outlook on life and how you live day to day. I'm not saying there's some ratio where if you watch an hour of news, you got to read an hour of Habakkuk. But you can. I mean, it doesn't take you an hour. If it takes you an hour to read Habakkuk, something's wrong. But I'm just saying as an example, all right? You don't have to spend all of your time in this. There's not a ratio. But I am telling you, your worldview should be formed not by the things of this world, but by God's word. This is what you should be consumed with, because this is what you'll be comforted by. And this is going to be the only way to make it through 2021, right? You need this message. So give yourself to the comfort of God's word. Be comforted by His promises to you. Be comforted in this Christmas season, because in it, again, is the kernel of what is the hope of the gospel itself. Let's stand together. And I'm going to pray. After I pray, we will then sing about this good news, the message that comes to us from the angels about this glorious gospel of Jesus Christ. Father God, we bow before you, grateful once again for your word to us. We are grateful for the comfort that has come to us in Christ. We thank you for the hope of this first coming. We thank you for the hope to come in the second coming. And may we then live as your people, focused on your word and truth, that our minds and hearts are being shaped by what comes to us from your word. Bring your word to bear on our lives, that we might walk in faithfulness and obedience to you. That's in Christ's name we pray. Amen. Glory to the newborn King. Well, amen. Thank you for coming, being a part of this time of worship. It's been a blessing to be with God's people on this Lord's Day. I would invite you back to the next opportunity we will have to worship, and that will be Christmas Eve. So keep in mind, no activities tonight or Wednesday night, and trust that you'll have a blessed week, and hope that if I don't get a chance to see or talk to you again, that you'd have a Merry Christmas. Well, I just want to remind you, we'll have deacons at the doors. They will be available with offering plates if you came prepared to give. We're certainly grateful for anything that you would give to the ongoing ministry of the church. We're going to leave hearing from God's Word. So Aaron Allen, our minister to students, will come with the benediction.
Well, before we leave this morning, let us be reminded once more of this great truth about the Lord. John chapter 1, verse 14. The Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we have seen His glory, glory as of the only Son from the Father, full of grace and truth. So, church, may you proclaim the glory of the Word made flesh and the wonder of His gospel until He comes again and our faith may be sight. Amen. You're dismissed.